Greetings, YouTube family. Today we're going to be looking at the Zulu state under Chaka. So we're going to be looking at the rise of Chaka the Man and how he expanded the Zulu state to be a strong, powerful state which emerged in the Southern African part region. Chaka was born in 1787 as an illegitimate son of Senzangakona, who was a Zulu chief, and Nandi, a daughter of the Elangeni tribe. During the time of his birth, the Zulu was a small clan and was part of the Mthethwa clan. Chaka was rejected by his father together with his mother. He was raised among his mother's relatives and was ill-treated growing up, and this is believed to be the reason for his aggressive behavior later on in life. Chaka also grew up facing the stigma of being called an illegitimate child. Chaka wanted to prove his worth by becoming great. Chaka's apprenticeship. Chaka's potential was realized by Dingiswayo, who recruited him into one of his regiments. During his apprenticeship, he introduced a number of war tactics. In 1806, his father died and was succeeded by Sikujana. Dingiswayo then helped Chaka to seize power from Sikujana and became the Zulu king. It should be noted that Chaka was the youngest of the many sons of Senzangakona and was not eligible for the throne. As he had gained a lot of military experience from Dingiswayo, one of Chaka's tasks as soon as he rose to power was to make military reforms. Expansion of the Zulu state under Chaka. Chaka consolidated his power series of battles with neighboring states in which he raided, destroyed, and absorbed. By 1824, he had defeated all clans in the region or absorbed them into his state. If a state is defeated by Chaka, it was given three choices, that is, to be absorbed, resist, and continue being attacked, or emigrate. Chaka forced defeated chiefs to pay tribute. Chaka extended the borders of the Zulu state north up to the present-day Mozambique, west across the Drakensberg Mountains, and south to the regions of what would become the Transkei homeland. After Zwide was conquered by Chaka, he emigrated across the Pongola River and settled there. With a series of unending battles and attacks, especially from Chaka, the Mfekani was intensified. Many clans emigrated to distant parts in southern, central, and East Africa. Chaka managed to grow Zulu population of about 250,000 to 40,000 soldiers. Chaka's military innovation. Chaka did away with most of the military tactics that had been in existence in Nguniland and proved them. Chaka decided to abandon the long throwing spear as a guide because he thought it was inefficient and replaced it with a short stabbing one called ikhwa. The spear could be used more than once, unlike the long throwing spear. Chaka also introduced a longer and harder shield for more protection called ishlangu. The ishlangu was about 6 feet tall and 3 feet wide, with its base made from a layer of thick wood and had a handle affixed to its interior. The shield was layered with cowhide from about 1 to 3 inches thick. He taught his army how to hook the enemy with the shield, bringing him to the right and stabbing him using the ikhwa. Each regiment had a distinctive colored shield, with some using black, others white with black spot, among others with lower ranks getting darker colored shield. He supplied cowhide skins to his troops, kept them after battle as his property. Chaka abandoned the previously Nguni soldiers' wooden sandals. He believed the sandals to be heavy and slowed the pace of the soldiers. He ordered his troops to go to war barefoot for greater speed, toughening of feet and improving footing in warfare. Thus, Zulu soldiers became faster in pursuing the enemy. Soldiers who went against Chaka and wore sandals were killed. Chaka is believed to have trained his army in a march of about 80 kilometers per day over hot, thorny, and rocky terrain. Although some historians argue that the Kaawon formation introduced by Shaka was already in existence, Shaka was more effective in using this method. Shaka introduced the Kaawon formation, in which his troops would be divided to form a Kaawon shape when attacking the enemy, as compared to the previously used mass combat. The Zulu regiment divided into four groups to be positioned as a Kaawon. The bravest soldiers were placed in the middle of the horn, and these directly attacked the enemy, whilst the younger soldiers made the horn. A reserve army was placed at the back of the horn. In case of stiff attack, the bravest soldiers would retreat and be replaced by the reserve army. Any soldier who returned with a wound in the back was killed, as he was labeled a coward. He put spies and informers everywhere. Unlike other Nguni leaders who employed limited warfare to allow the enemy to recuperate and accept dominance of the winning chief, Shaka introduced total warfare. Total warfare was simply based on the knowledge that everyone participated in the war, either as soldiers or giving soldiers help. Total warfare also meant destroying the enemy completely so that they won't be able to recover. Shaka removed the ruling family of the conquered group and replaced them with relatives of those he selected. Young men and women of defeated chiefdoms would be inscripted into the Zulu regiment. Young women of the Zulu state were assembled at the military settlement. They were officially wards of the king. They were organized in female regiments equal to those of the male Amabutho, and they took part in ceremonial displays and dances. They were given to the male Amabutho in marriage. Until retirement time, however, sexual relations between male and female age Amabutho was not allowed. Those who did not follow this rule were punished by death. The regiment were kept in the barracks permanently. The army was supported by the state. The army was well disciplined and trained. Shaka made sure that his army was well fed, and they were fed on beef mostly. Shaka had an army of about 20,000 soldiers. During battle time, small boys were employed as baggage carriers. Shaka abolished circumcision. Nurses and doctors were assigned to treat wounded soldiers. Shaka's soldiers were also known as Amabutho. The military indunas or captains got many cattle from the king, as they were his favorites. They were able to build huge personal followings. They were able-bodied men who were 40 years and below and were recruited into the army. All able-bodied men who were 40 years and below were recruited into the army. Soldiers in Shaka's army served up to 40 years. The army always lived in the barrack and were occasionally allowed short visits home. Shaka continued with the regimental system he had learned from Genghis Khan. Shaka's army was organized into regiments. These regiments were organized by age. Regiments were formed of recruits from all backgrounds, and this promoted unity. All the Zulu soldiers were happy being part of the army, as it won most of its battles. The political organization of the Zulu state. The smallest political unit was the kraal or village, and it was under the rule of the kraal head or umnunzane. The isigodi was in charge of a large area called Isifunda and one induna. Shaka was the image of the law. The king represented a tribal ancestors, therefore officiated at all ceremonies in the land. The king represented the kingdom. Shaka had all legislative, judicial, and political powers. The king was responsible for land distribution. Shaka appointed his female relative to administer female regiments. Shaka appointed his relatives in all the important positions. Shaka's rule was custom with little opportunity of legislation. After the Inqwala ceremony, the laws were announced publicly, especially those to do with marriage and campaigns that the king had decided upon. The king could not order the killing of a subject unless they were found guilty of an offense, and this limited the powers of the king. The king ruled with counselors who were heads of families of influence called Indunas. The Indunas were divided into two groups. One dealt with the military, whilst the other in administration issues. Counselors had to reside at the royal court for a certain period and offer their services to the king. This helped the king in state surveillance and also so that he knew what was happening even in the most remote areas of the kingdom. The king employed royal spies who were stationed everywhere in the state. Besides the Indunas, there were also other important men who were favorites at the royal court, even but did not hold official posts, known as Isilomo and Umsengi. The Zulu subjects paid tribute to their king in terms of livestock, iron tools, grains, minerals, among others. Shaka also received tributes from vassal chiefs. The king could collect cattle from his subjects at any time to feed his council and army. The king could also collect tax from subjects irregularly in the form of mats, labor, and thatching grass. The social organization of the Zulu state. There was division of labor in the Zulu state, that is, men did cattle rearing whilst women did agriculture. Boys were taught to be aggressive whilst girls were taught to be submissive. The Zulus celebrated the Inqwala ceremony, which was a festival of the first fruits. Conquered kingdoms were supposed to speak the Zulu language and follow the Zulu culture. The kingdom had three distinct social classes, which were the king and the royal family, those incorporated when the Zulu was expanding, those absorbed during the Mfekane. The lower two classes were required to pay tribute to Shaka as a sign of allegiance. All able-bodied men were to marry at 40 after serving the army. Cattle was seen as a sign of wealth and status. Men with many cattle married many wives. Cattle were also used to pay traditional doctors' fees. The king was the center of the unit. The Zulu men and women were educated in edge regiments. Edge regiments fostered unity because people of different backgrounds were brought together. Marriage alliances encouraged unity and coexistence in the state, with the marriage function presided over by the king. The Zulu had many festivals, for example, dissolving of the edge regiments, the first fruits harvest in Kwala, to thank their gods for good yields, and Shaka presided over all the ceremonies. The Zulu assimilated conquered people to look similar to original Zulus. They were religious, and religion was used to enforce unity, where all people believed in the spirits of the ancestors and the living dead. The king presided over all religious ceremonies. Now we're going to be looking at the assassination of Shaka, the reasons why Shaka was assassinated. He was an absolute ruler or tyrant. He disrespected and often humiliated traditional chiefs. He did not consult with his commanders, and he dismissed commanders too often for petty reasons. He killed his subjects for petty offenses. He killed any girl whom he impregnated because he did not want a successor. Man, that's bad, y'all. He did not give his relatives positions of authority. The army became exhausted as a result of endless military campaigns. Chaka's successes made his relatives Dingane and Mhlangane jealousy and went to usurp the throne. Mkabayi suspected Chaka of killing his mother.